So good morning, and the peace of Christ be with you all. So today we are blessed. I get a Sunday mostly off. I didn't have to cram a sermon into my brain this morning. And thanks to the youth who have been willing to do this service, and we get to hear about their mission trip and what that week was like for them. So it is a really great day, I believe, for hearing the voice of our youth. And I love the rocks up here. You know me and rocks. I like rocks. Okay. I do want to let you all know, some of you know, if you were here last week, I had visitors from Florida. And I took them on a tour first when nobody was here. And they were so impressed with how pristine condition this church was and how you all must really love this church because you take such great care of it. I mean, I heard that comment over and over. And also, they were super impressed that we had some youth at that coffee hour who were working extra hard. I heard that one a number of times, too. Just seeing the youth being gracious and working and helping, they were impressed. But most of all, they were impressed with the welcome of this church. So yay, congregation, you did it. Not just afterwards, after you knew who they were, but even before worship even started, a number of you came up and welcomed them. So thank you. I'm glad to hear that. Next Sunday is our outdoor worship at 10 a.m. 10 a.m. You get an extra hour of sleep because following the outdoor worship, we have a potluck, and you will want to bring a dish to share. And if for any reason the weather does not cooperate, we'll be in here and have our potluck upstairs. But let's pray for good weather because I have not had that wonderful experience with you yet. September is really quickly falling upon us. Yeah, we know, counting down the days to school starts. Yeah. Okay. And so there's a number of things that we have to get into our heads and prepare for that. First off, Labor Day, which is Communion Sunday, that Labor Day Sunday, I invite you to wear something that represents the work you are currently doing or have done. Or if it's not something you can put on you, then bring a small token of it and let's celebrate the work that is done in ministry by this church out in the world. Wednesday, September 13th, Rally Day for our new Peace Power Night. Put that on your calendar at 6:00 in the evening. Also that day, we're going to start an adult Bible study at 1:00 on Wednesdays. It will be weekly. September 17th highlights, it's in your bulletin, but all church school teachers and all public school teachers and aides, we will commission you that day. And also it's the day to gather the waters. We now will have 2 baptisms in October, so we want to gather those waters. And also it will be the day of our mission fair. So if you are quilters or prayer shawl knitters or are on a board or on some kind of a task force, we invite you to have a display, and we're going to enjoy everything that this church does together, and it will be in the fellowship following the coffee hour. But Sue does need to know, actually Gary needs to know, if you need a table or a half a table or whatever for your display, so please call the church and let them know what your needs are. There is an event called Toward One Wausau that will be on Monday, September 18th, and it should be in your bulletin with a registration thing. So if the racial tension that has been in our nation has churned up in you where you'd like something to do, that's a good event. I'm going to it, and I invite you to join me Toward One Wausau to look at the diversity in our own community and find ways to come together. Are there other announcements for today? Betty.
Just a quick, huge thank you to everyone who helped, provided, came, advertised for the Pie and Ice Cream Social. Again, our youth came through. Sam and Will were here. Dylan was here. I almost called him by his brother's name. So thank you again for everyone for all your help. It was a great time by all, I'm sure. Thank you.
I enjoyed it. It was a great event.
Yeah, kudos, projectors,
yay.
Mike Loomis, Dan, rock on.
Thank you to everybody who contributed to make that happen. They're up and running. Anything else? Okay, let us open our hearts and our minds now to hear from the youth.
Well, if you'd all stand and join us in our gathering song. The music today is a mix of contemporary music, which the kids were exposed to in the trip, but also a great soloist and great pianist will provide a little bit more traditional hymn music later in the service. So let's all have fun singing Here I Am to Worship.
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see. Beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. So highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, all for love's sake.
Here I am to worship, here I am.
Please join me in our call to worship. Jesus is here, before, now, and forever. God is everywhere. The Holy Spirit dwells within us. Please join us in our opening hymn, My Lighthouse, which, by the way, does involve some clapping.
In my wrestling and in my doubts, in my failures, you won't walk out. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Whoa, you are the peace in my troubled sea. In the silence, you won't let go. In the questions, your truth will hold. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Whoa, you are the peace in my troubled sea. My lighthouse, my lighthouse, shining in the darkness, I will follow you. To shore, safe to shore, safe to shore, safe to shore.
I won't fear what tomorrow brings. With each morning, I'll rise and sing. My God's love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Whoa, you are the peace in my troubled sea. Oh, you are my light, my lighthouse, my lighthouse, shining in the darkness, I will follow you. Oh, my lighthouse, my lighthouse, I will trust the promise, you will carry me safe to shore.
Please join me in the opening prayer. Precious Savior, we long to walk with you always. Your sacrifice frees us to listen and learn, and to teach family, friends, and strangers around us. Your word is the ultimate power, and while we sometimes find ourselves straying, deep inside, we know that you are always by our side, watching, waiting, whispering, until that time we find you again. Amen. You may be seated. That's my niece, by the way. Today's scripture reading is exactly what our mission trip was based on. The entire week was spent studying this scripture in depth, in a very contemporary way. It's Luke 24, the entire chapter, verses 1 through 53. So bear with me. But on the first day of the week, at early dawn, they came to the tomb, taking the spices that they had prepared. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they went in, they did not find the body. While they were perplexed about this, suddenly two men in dazzling clothes stood beside them. The women were terrified and bowed their heads to the ground. But the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here, but has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still in Galilee, that the Son of Man must be handed over to sinners and be crucified, and on the third day rise again." Then they remembered his words, and returning from the tomb, they told all this to the 11 and to all the rest. Now it was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary, and the mother of James, and the other women with them who told this to the apostles. But these words seemed to them an idle tale, and they did not believe him. But Peter got up and ran to the tomb. Stooping and looking in, he saw the linen cloths by themselves. Then he went home, amazed at what had happened. Now on that same day, two of them were going to the village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them. But their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you walk along?" They stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place in these days?" He asked them, "What things?" They replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see him." Then he said to them, "Oh, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory? Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself in all the scriptures. As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, 'Stay with us, because it is almost evening, and the day is now nearly over.' So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, 'Were not our hearts burning within us?' While he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us, That same hour they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, "The Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon." Then they told what was happened on the road, and how he had been known to them in the breaking of the bread. While they were talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and terrified, and thought they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I myself. Touch me and see. For a ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have." And when he said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. While in their joy they were disbelieving and still wondering, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate in their presence. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written, that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning with Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things, and see, I am sending upon you what my Father promised, so that here in the city, until you have been clothed with power from on high." Then he led them out as far as Bethany, and lifting up his hands, he blessed them. While he was blessing them, he withdrew from them and was carried up into the heaven. And they worshiped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy. And they were continually in the temple blessing God. As these words guide us through everything we do in our life, this was their guiding scripture for the week. At this point, I'd like to ask the youth to join me, along with any of the other children that would love to come up and talk. I have a present for you.
So one of the things they did when they got to the work site was we all had to grab a rock from our work sites. We didn't know why. They just said, "Grab a rock," and we're a little bit like lemming, so we agreed. "Good morning. How are you today, con man? Good to see you." "Huh? Yeah, yeah. And how are you today?" "Here's my present to you." You know what that is? So we took that rock back, and they cleaned them for us. I didn't clean these rocks, sorry. But I'm going to let the kids keep the rocks. Now, you have to promise me one thing. You can't ever use the rock for a weapon, okay? You have to keep the rock in a safe place, okay? In the water, that works. All right. So later on in the week, they brought us all together. And they brought us in front of the cross. Can one of you point where the cross is? You see the cross? Yeah, very good. And what does that cross represent? Do you know?
No.
Yeah.
What does it represent?
Well. Oh, great.
Yeah, the microphone scared you. Sorry. Go ahead and say it.
It would represent people being like bad, really bad people.
Well, that's true. That is in its time, that is what it represented. Yeah, to us, it represents the risen Christ. Okay? Meaning that he was crucified and he died, and then 3 days later came back from the dead. That's the resurrection. Okay? So what they told us was that not to only worship the cross. The cross isn't what we worship. We worship what isn't there, and that's Jesus Christ. And then they gave us the rocks back. They had us meditate in front of the cross, and each one of them got their own rock. And they brought that rock back to us, me, and we said to them, the cross is not the end of the road. Jesus is alive and well among us. Go with him. And what that means is that every time we do something, everything we do, like let's walk down the aisle. Come with me. Do you think Jesus is with you right now? Yeah. Do you know that for certain? Yeah. Everything we do, Jesus travels with us. He walks all the roads. He guides us on our paths. He tells us what to do, right? And that's that little voice in the back of our head saying, hey, if I break my sister's toy, that's not a good thing, right? Because when we do things like that, we know it's wrong. That's God talking to us. You don't remember breaking your sister's toy. Amnesia, right? Yeah. Oh, so, yeah, okay. Yeah. All right. There'll come a time. Don't worry. So that little trip we took, Jesus was traveling with us the entire time. And believe it or not, was talking to us, was guiding us, was telling us things to do. Because as we go through life, we have to remember that Jesus is always with us. So that's the reason I gave you that rock. Because Jesus is in everything and everywhere. Just like God and the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit dwells in you to help guide you and teach you. So here's what that rock in your hand can represent. Because a rock is a solid thing, right? It's really hard. Huh? Yeah. The rock is a hard thing. It's solid. It's something we can grasp, right? It gives us the ability to know that it's with us, right? Well, I don't want you to worship the rock. But when you hold that rock, remember that Jesus, like the rock, is always with you. And even if you take that rock and you throw it into the water, Jesus is still going to be there because you know that rock is there, right? And just like you told me, you know Jesus is traveling with you. Yeah, if a muskie, so well, then you've helped the muskie, right? So. All right, so I want you to take that rock, and you can do whatever you want with it, except break windows, okay? Not a weapon, okay? And I want you to do what you want to do with the rock. But remember that the rock is a small representation of Jesus, who's always in our life, he's always solid, and he's always strong. The water, that's right. All right, let's go back to your parents. Remember your rock. Why don't you guys... You go, yeah, turn your seat, but I'm going to have you come back up right away. So thanks to Danielle, who put together a lovely video presentation. And by the way, this is its premiere. We're going to enjoy some photos taken throughout our trip.
Well, as you may have noticed, some of the pictures that were obviously taken earlier in the week, we looked far cleaner and more well-groomed than we ended up later in the week. And while most of the pictures showed them having a whole lot of fun, which they did, they also did a lot of hard work. The purpose of the mission trip itself is to go into the community and go to the houses of people that can't afford or are unable to fix their houses. The resident that I worked with, it was an 81-year-old nice woman who you saw the photo of me with her, whose husband suffered from dementia, had recently lost a leg, and was wheelchair-bound, and had no way to really get out of their house. They had a deck out the front of their house that had a step down. So she struggled to get him in and out of the house to doctor's appointments. So we tore off the smaller part of the deck, rebuilt it, and then added a ramp to her driveway. And that was the hard work all of us did. We were all involved in that sort of thing. So at this point, I'm going to have the youth come up, and they've been dreading this all week long, I guarantee it. But I'm going to have them express their feelings, how it may have changed them or what their thoughts are, and even open up the floor to questions after they sort of express that. So if anybody has any questions about how. And the unique part about it is while we were there to do the work that God had asked us to do, we spent just as much time worshiping God and working God into our lives, not on one day, but all days. And that's we'll talk about later. So if the youth want to come up now, I have the scary microphone for you. Did you hear the sigh? Big sigh. I don't want to do this. So anybody can start. You can speak for as long as you want.
I'm forced to.
You're forced to. So say your name.
Hi, my name is Allie Zimmerman. And
just go ahead and start.
All right. About 5 weeks ago, I was able to go on a trip that was almost 1,000 miles away that changed my life for the better. What I learned, felt, and got to experience is something that I've never wanted to change. And yes, the car sickness was worth it. When we got there, we were given the best hospitality by the staff. They were so kind and helpful, and they did everything in their power to make our trip so great. Our first day of work couldn't have gone any better. I met my amazing crew, and I made so many new friends. Our resident couldn't have been better either. He never failed to help with our work, and he also provided his home on the rainy days and water and soda on the hot. This trip let me meet new friends, learn so many new things, and help me connect more with my God.
I'm Dylan. The main thing that affected me was getting to see how just painting a house could change how the resident lives, I guess.
Okay, I'm Allie. The mission trip was a great experience because it allowed me to meet new people and make new friends. I enjoyed working with my crew and creating an impact on our resident.
So something that we did over the week is when we first got there, they told us to be on the lookout for God sightings while we worked. So what they were is they kind of just said it's positive things that you see around you, even like simple things. So an example I always remember is there was a work crew working on a house and they didn't really know what they're doing too much, I guess, and they didn't think they were gonna finish in time. But there was a guy walking home from work and he took like a different way that day because there was road construction, and he happened to be going past that house and ended up helping them finish the house, and they probably wouldn't have without him. So that's like an example of a God sighting. So after like the whole week of just everyday hearing all the good things going on around you, it really opens your eyes of how much positive there really is going on.
I thought it was cool because our residents were Jehovah's Witness, and at first they'd sat out of the devotions. They didn't want anything to do with us being there, which was kind of whatever. But so then by the end of the week, they were participating in the devotions. And I mean, I learned so much about what their faith was, and they learned about what ours was. And I just thought that was cool that we could just unite together.
Hi. Okay, so yeah, I really enjoyed this trip. I met a lot of new people, and my resident was fantabulous. Her name was Carol Ann. She survived breast cancer and a stroke. She lives by herself. Actually, she lives with her only son, I think. Yeah. But she needed help with her trim on her trailer. I worked on a donkey farm. It was pretty cool. She wanted us to ride the donkeys, but it was raining, so, you know. But yeah, it was really fun.
So you guys can sit back down. Oh, sorry, I forgot about questions. Yeah, I said I'd open up to questions. I lied to you. Are there any questions? Is anybody, I mean, you know, as I mentioned, we, or as somebody mentioned, I don't remember who said it, we traveled a great distance. It was, we put 2,500 miles on the van by the time we were done. It was a 10-hour drive to the first church we stayed at, which was in Olmsted, Ohio. It was a 10-hour drive there, and then a 6-hour drive to Newark Valley, where we stayed in that church, which in itself was a great experience, because the church in Olmsted was 100 years old, but they were obviously a little bit well-to-do. They're a little, you know, a richer community. I think they probably have an endowment. Everything was good. And then the second church had an actual congregation of 21 people. When we worshiped with them on Sunday, we're fairly certain we outnumbered the congregation. So it was an interesting experience in how churches...
Use the mic.
Oh. Sorry, yeah, I
forgot. But I'm not standing in front of a microphone. I was saying it was an interesting experience as how the two churches, while one was well-to-do and one was obviously struggling, how devoted they all were to their church. It wasn't about the size of their church. It was about how they worshiped and how they came together to create the community they had. And both of them were strong communities. I don't think either one of them's closing anytime soon, unless the second one continues to lose members. But Eric, you had a question? Or somebody had a question?
Yeah, I didn't have a question. I just wanted to thank you, Mike, for leading this journey, and all the volunteers that helped, and to all the youth for going, because it's a great mission. Thank you.
Thank you, Eric. And it was my pleasure, but I didn't do it for myself. I did it for them to experience what they can out of it. And I truly believe they all got something out of it, whether they expressed it to you or not today. My job was to observe them. And throughout the week, I observed subtle changes in each and every one of them. The little things they would say during their devotions at night meant something. Maybe not to them, but certainly from an outsider, to watch the change happen in them. Karen.
Yeah. Come on. Oh, okay, we're good. So also I wanted to thank the congregation for all of your support and our seemingly endless fundraisers, but you know, we needed to raise about $8,000, and I think in the end we raised about $8,700, so that was awesome. So big thank you to all of you that came to the breakfast and bought our truffles and pizzas and flowers and everything else that we sold. And we are not planning a big major outlay of cash mission trip for next summer, but we will for the following. So we will be starting our fundraising again, and we'll look forward to your continued support with that as well.
Yeah, and Karen is absolutely right. Without you donating the money you did or buying the flowers, this trip couldn't have happened. It's not cheap, and we knew that. But that is more than just fundraising. It's an investment in your community. It's an investment in their growth. And that's something we have to remember, that it's not about us as adults being in our community that we already have. It's about fortifying their community so they have that community to come back to when they decide it's time.
I'm curious, how many in this congregation have been on some kind of a mission trip? Did you do it as youth? How many of you did it as youth? A few. Yeah, my daughter knows it well. Yeah. Well, Wesleyskis.
Well, and the question I'll ask them, sort of expanding upon that, is as youth, the mission trip you took, do you think it will have a profound impact in your life, throughout your life?
Yes?
Yeah, they're all nodding their heads. Yeah, I mean, absolutely. I mean, I'm 47, okay, I'm 48 now. Yeah. Three years ago was my first mission trip, and that had a profound effect on my life. So two more, you know, going, and I'm not going to say that each one of them had the same experience. I'm sure they didn't. They didn't have the same experience I had. You know, that's that trip we're all on. That's that wonderful journey we all take. But I know that they got something out of it, good or bad, but it'll stay with them forever. And they'll learn from it, and they'll talk, and they'll listen, and they'll be there and take the understanding that sometimes we have to go outside our comfort zone to do the work that Jesus has asked us to do. And that's a big, important part of how that mission trip was structured. So we'll talk about that shortly. Are there any other questions real quick? Perfect. Would you like to sit down now? Okay. I look at my wife because she didn't want me to say this. I've been sick all week. So excuse my voice. I'm going to tell you a story about a rock. It's a very big rock. The first day we were digging at our crew site, one of the students was digging, and she hit a big rock. And as it popped up, I looked at it, she looked at it, we both at the exact same time said, potato, because it looked exactly like a potato. But of course, it was a rock. But being youth, and I include myself in this, we ran with it. We renamed the rock Pat-tato. And the rock became our mascot. And we had decided that every day one of them would take the rock and take care of the rock. So the first girl, Faith Ann, who was a lovely, vivacious young lady, took the rock back and was showing it to her group that she had traveled with. She came back to us the next day, and she said, I have bad news. What do you mean you have bad news? She says, Pat-tato is gone. What happened? Well, she was showing it to one of her friends, and her friend took the rock and threw it. Pat-tato was gone. They searched. They couldn't find him. That was on Tuesday. Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. Friday, we're wrapping up our services, getting ready to go home. And one of the other youth from the crew comes up with the microphone, has something behind her back. She has good news. Pat-tato has been found. So, of course, we ran with that. Because Pat-tato was something we all loved. Pat-tato was teaching us things. Pat-tato was arrested, crucified, and was killed, taken from us. And 3 days later, Pat-tato returned to us. Now, I reminded them, don't worship the rock. But I think it was extremely significant to all of them how important that rock was. Because then we all took that rock and we all signed it and we gave it to an amazing young gentleman who, 2 weeks after getting back from his mission trip, was joining the United States Marine Corps. An honor and a commitment that all of us were astounded by. So that's my story of the potato. So the entire week was a structured week of getting up, eating,
going together as a group, going to your work site, doing the work that was needed, taking a break for lunch, and most importantly, having a devotion with your crew during that lunch, going back to work. We all worked till about 3 in the afternoon. Going back to the site, the housing, the school, we would all eat dinner. Then we'd all get together in this large group, and we would praise God. We'd do it in a very informal, non-denominational, non-judgmental way. And it was amazing to watch all of these youth from across the country that come from 12 different states. There was 350 of us, different denominations, different ethnic groups, different philosophies, different theologies, but yet we all came with the same purpose. We all worshiped the same way. The one thing they always give you on these mission trips is one of these books. This is your guidebook. They tell you, don't lose your guidebook. Everything you need to know and everything you're going to do for the week is in the guidebook. We use it for devotions at night. We use it during the day. We use it all week long. This is what we use to travel down that road. And I can't help but think that we need to remind ourselves, just as they said to the youth, this is your guidebook. Sometimes we forget. This can be your guidebook too. What if we all carried our Bible around? And what if we all referred to the messages that were in it to guide us through our everyday life, to do everything that we do based on what this is trying to teach us? And as we talk about traveling the road, just as the disciples traveled the road to Emmaus, we were all headed down that same road. It was all going to the same place. But every once in a while, somebody would go off on a different path. Every once in a while, somebody would turn around and head the wrong direction. It's just like us and everything we do in our daily lives. This is the religious journey we're on. We take the knowledge we think we know. We apply it to some things we do. And just like the disciples did, sometimes we forget. Sometimes we doubt, but no matter what, God and Jesus and the Holy Spirit will always be there for us. Sometimes we just have to remember to take a different path, to turn around the other way and look and listen. God is always talking. Jesus is always whispering, and the Holy Spirit inside of us is guiding us in everything we do. So then they were given roles. Every crew has 5 roles they have to do. Work director, break director, crew master, one gets the tools, et cetera, et cetera. And nobody, it doesn't, there's no adult role. I as an adult wasn't the work director. I didn't command what they did. I could have just as easily been the person who made the sandwiches. They give the youth the power to take any position they want. It empowers them. It gives them the ability to learn. Just like in church, we have to remember we all have a role. We all have a duty in what we do in this community. Yes, we're all individuals. We're all individuals on a path individually. But that road all leads to the same place. That road has guideposts that all say the same thing. Sometimes we just choose to ignore them. And just like at their sites, they all worked for a common cause. We come to church, we listen, we pray, we decide what our ministries are. We all do it for the same reason. Greatest thing about Luke 24 that struck me over and over and over was that no matter how many times Jesus said to them, listen, listen, this is what I'm saying. They were still astonished when they rolled back the stone and he was gone. He told them he would be resurrected. Yet they forgot. And even when they were confronted by Jesus, they still doubted. It's part of our road. It's part of our path. But all of that created confusion. And the disciples, when they discovered the empty tomb, headed home. They headed home because that's where they would feel comfortable. Even when Jesus met them on the road, they weren't able to see who he was. Even as he's talking to them. Now, these were people that had hung with Jesus for a long time. They had been with him. They had learned from him. He had taught them. And yet, they were still unable to recognize him. Even when he asked them what they were doing, and they said, are you the only person in Jerusalem that doesn't know this? Are you the only person who doesn't understand? They had doubts. They had disappointments. But then Jesus revealed himself in the most astonishing way, the breaking of the bread, that simple gesture, that sharing of his body, and created within them hope. They finally realized what it all meant. That they, on their path, whatever it was, they had hope. And everything they do, and everything they do for people, there's hope. We talked about the ups and downs. We had to create a graph of our lives. Start at birth. Mine started up here at birth, kind of went through my youth. Went through my teenage years, kind of hit rock bottom in high school. Then after high school, I had two children back up on top of the world, Ma. Then it kind of went south from there. Dark point in my life, absolute rock bottom. Met Paula. Life has its ups and downs. My life, since I met Paula, has been an all-time high. It's had its low points. Cancer's never a high. But from that, it helped me to recognize Christ in my life. It helped me to realize that I couldn't rely upon myself to be the person I needed to be. I looked to you. So what that represents is that no matter where we are, who you are in life's journey, you will always be accepted here. Jesus has a place for you. You just have to listen. And even when you don't listen, he's still there. That whispering voice inside of you, that guiding book, is telling you what to do. We all sin. We all make mistakes. Jesus made the ultimate sacrifice, so we were all forgiven. That's the same path we're on. And in the end, we'll all be at the end of that path together. And then once the bread was broken and they realized this is our Messiah, this is our Savior, created a hunger in them, a hunger to know, to learn, to grow. That's a hunger I hope these kids got out of that mission trip. It's a hunger that each one of us should have or work towards every day of our life. To know the work that we're doing will have a positive effect. And then out of that, we get joy. We get that feeling of, I have done a great thing. I helped someone who couldn't help themselves. And by doing that, it lifted them up. Every day, we make mistakes. Every day, we may choose the wrong path. But if we turn around and repent, Jesus will still be there. And that path, no matter how far we go from it, or how far we get away back to it, will always lead home. So the next time you're doing what you do, think of that Holy Spirit within you and ask yourself, what is it trying to tell me? How am I listening to it? Why am I doubting it? What is it attempting to reveal to me? And use that as your guidebook and share it with the rest of us. Jesus, God, and the Holy Spirit, all in one, mighty powerful, our ultimate source of knowledge. Amen. All right, kids, one more time. Stand up and sing. Join me in our hymn of response, Your Love Ran Red. Actually, it's At the Cross.
There's a place where mercy reigns and never dies. There's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide, where all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, at the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you, I'm in all of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white, I owe all to you, I owe all to you, Jesus. There's a place where sin and shame are powerless, where my heart has peace with God and forgiveness, where all the love I've ever flow.
You may be seated. Are there any prayer requests for today? Karen.
One of the students couldn't be with us today, Paige Streveler, and her mother said she wanted me to share the following news with you. She wants you all to know, but she's having a hard time talking about it. Excuse me. Paige's father, Greg Streveler, was struck down with MS he was maybe 30 years old. And sadly, his journey here on earth is coming to a close. He's been blessed that he's been cared for lovingly by his parents. They've been his caregivers. However, Paige's grandpa passed away this year as well. So Greg was an amazing father. He had horrible disability, yet always made an effort to be there for his girls. They have a very loving relationship with him, and they are choosing to spend the last few days that he has with them. That's why she's not here today. But just prayers to the Streveler family. Paige, you know, is 15 years old. Her sister just graduated from high school. They've lost their grandpa, and now they're going to lose their father. And it's just a sadness that no child should have to go through. So please think of the Streveler family this week, and Paige especially. Thank you.
Thank you, Karen. Any other prayers? Let us be in prayer. God of love and grace, we thank you for the blessing of the youth of this church and the voice of their witness today and of Michael's. May our ears continue to be open to hearing your still speaking word to us. You speak to us with renewed awakenings through the eyes of a child, as visions of the way forward by the words of our youth, and in the experienced wisdom of our elders. So give us ears to hear all the ways in which you speak to us. You speak to us in the words of songs, of new songs, of old songs, and of soloists that we treasure. And we thank you for Kendra's presence this day. We affirm our youth for their willingness to go beyond their comfort zones and out into the world to serve you. And our youth have returned to us with a greater awareness and understanding the needs of others beyond the confines of this community. So may your spirit continue to embolden them to serve at home and in the world, wherever you may call them to share their gifts and your love. We thank you for the deepening relationships they experienced, learning how to love one another, even when they disagreed, and the abiding appreciation that grew in their hearts through the overwhelming welcome by Newark Valley UCC. And we pray for Newark Valley that your ministry may continue to be nurtured in their community. And although this, your church in New York, is small in size, your people there are huge in heart. So may the love that they know extend outward and build up their church and multiply their membership as a greater witness of hope in their community. And may the witness of Newark Valley's extravagant hospitality to our youth open our hearts even greater to extend hospitality within our church and to all whom you send our way. And may your love and your peace of both faith communities shine forth into this hurting world. So God, we pray for peace, peace among the nations, especially with North Korea and in Spain, in their grief. Peace infused amid the divisions caused by racism, peace in the diversity of our own community, and peace at the core of our souls. May we learn to live into Christ's desire that we may all be one. One in humanity, one in God. And where we may call you by different names and discover you by different paths, may we be wholly one in your love. And where there is pain and sorrow and suffering in our faith community, we ask you to shower your tender mercy upon them. And we especially pray this day for Paige and the loss of her father and her grandfather. And we ask that these last few moments together be a time of great peace, an awareness of a joy that even in the midst of the grief, that you are there in unbelievable ways, a peace that passes all understanding. Hear now the individual silent prayers of our hearts. Holy Christ, you call us to be witnesses of your love and peace. Convict our hearts to live it, as our youth have so willingly done, so that your realm of peace may come to earth. Together we pray as Jesus Christ taught us to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not in our temptation, but deliver thee. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. You know, today is a wonderful example of the spiritual value of the resources that we share in this church, and all that you have given in the past to help these youth attend in New York and be our witnesses there. So let us continue to give, to minister to our youth, to our children, as well as to our adults. And who knows, maybe next year this will be an intergenerational mission trip. Let us receive our offering.
Please join me in our offertory prayer. Loving leader and protector, our roads will differ greatly, as our lives can never be a match to anyone else. Troubled times will fall upon us, and many times we will lose track of you and your teaching. It comforts us to know that you will always be there when we turn back to the correct path. Our gifts today are but a small way for us to help those among us and those we have yet to meet to find their way to you. Amen. Dan, that was a test. So now, take a step back. No, I'm sorry. Yes, we'll take a step forward And if you'll stay standing and we'll sing Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone.
Ladies and gentlemen, friends, family, we are all beginning to travel down the road together. We will all choose the path that we decide to go, but in the end, we are all forgiven. We will all go home. This Jesus has taught us. Sometimes you'll forget, and sometimes you'll doubt, but always remember, Jesus will be there for you. Now,
pass the glory, whatever teacher the name. So if you'd like to join us, go ahead and follow through. It's an easy yes. Come on.
You got the energy. Come on. All right. Yeah, baby. Make it. Celebrate our youth as we go out. Youth, follow out with Mike. Three minutes over, but oh well.